Vivian, I, Vivian Tanushi Sahani from Faculty of Law and Governance from Jayati Vidyapeeth Women's University, am going to discuss the topic named Pleading, Plaint and Written Statement. The basic overview of all three of them. This is under the subject Drafting, Pleading and Convincing, which is further applicable to LLB 4th SEM. Are the basically the backbone of the legal profession. It is the foundation stone on which the case of a party stands. The case of a party must be set out in the pleadings. Moreover, the relief cannot be claimed on the grounds which are not contained in the pleadings. The immaterial or vague or ambiguous matter should be avoided, and the pleadings should be properly framed. In the case named Devaki Nandan versus Muralidhar, it was held that a finding cannot be sustained which is based on no pleading and no evidence. That is, that if you need to file a case, if you want to file a case, you must support your case with proper drafting, with proper evidence. Otherwise, definitely your case will not be so strong that why the judge will give the decision in your favor. Moving further, pleadings are those materials or essential facts which are necessary to be averred in order to put forward a cause or to establish defense in a judicial proceeding. It is the backbone of the suit upon which the entire advice of the suit rests. It includes allegations and counter-allegations made by one party and denied by the other. It means that a formal statement to propound the cause of action or set up a defense against the case of the plaintiff. Now, there is a person named Mova. According to Mova, pleadings are the statement in writing drawn up and filed by each party to a case stating what his contentions will be at the trial and giving all such details as his opponent needs to know in order to prepare his case in the answer. Now, Order 6 of the Code of CPC 1908 deals with the pleadings in the general. Rule 1 defines pleading. Rule 2 defines the fundamental principles of the pleading. Rule 3 to 13 requires the parties to supply necessary particulars. Rule 14 and Rule 15 provide for signing and verification of the pleadings. Rule 16 empowers the court to strike out unnecessary pleadings. Rule 17 and Rule 18 contain provisions relating to the amendment of the pleadings. Then, as per Rule 1 of Order 6 of CPC 1908, pleading is defined as a plaint or a written statement. I already told you that you can understand that the concept of pleading equals to plaint plus written statement. It is important to know here the meaning of the plaint and the written statement. Plaint is the statement of the plaintiff containing grievances in order to initiate an action in the court of law. It helps the court to determine the real nature of the suit. Written statement is the statement or defense of the defendant by which either admits the claim of the plaintiffs or denies the allegation or averments made by the plaintiff in his plaint. Moving further, what are the other objects of pleading? So, is the legal theory, that is the factual situations based on which the plaintiff claims to have been suffered, and the second is the legal remedy that the plaintiff seeks from the court. A plaint is considered as an important concept because it is the foremost and the initial stage to initiate any lawsuit and helps to find a civil court of an appropriate jurisdiction. Now, we can say that Order 7 of the CPC, that is Civil Procedure Code, deals particularly with the plaint. Now, in Order 7 of CPC, there are many different rules which deal with different constituents of the plaint. So, there are many rules in it also. Moving forward from rules, Rule 1 to Rule 8 deals with the particulars of the plaint. Rule 9 of the CPC deals with how the plaint will be admitted. And after that, Rule 10 to 10B talks about the return of the plaint and the appearance of the parties. And the main rules, that is 11 to 13, deal with the rejection of the plaint, and in such circumstances the plaint can be rejected. Now, Section 26 of the Civil Procedure Code deals with the institution of the suit. It states that every suit shall be instituted by the presentation of the plaint or in such another manner as may be prescribed. This section clearly shows that plaint is very much necessary for the establishment of the suit before the civil or the commercial suit. So, moving forward, we can check that what are the necessary contents of a plaint. A plaint is a legal document that contains a list of necessary contents in the absence of which it cannot be considered as a plaint. The contents necessary for a plaint are mentioned in Rule 1 to Rule 8 of Order 8, rather of Order 7 of CPC. These are further mentioned below. Now, what are they? First is that the plaint should contain the name of the commercial or the civil court where the suit or the case is being instituted. Now, second, plaint should also contain the details of the plaintiff, such as the name, address, and description. Third comes, plaint should contain the name, resident, and description of the defendant. Fourth is, when a plaintiff has some defects or problems in health or any type of disability, the plaint should contain a statement of these effects. Plaint should contain the facts due to which cause of action arises, and where the cause of action arises, it should also be mentioned. Plaint should not only mention facts due to which cause of action arises, but also those facts which help in recognizing the jurisdiction. Plaint should also contain about the reliefs which the plaintiff seeks from the court. Now, when the plaintiff is ready to set off a portion of his claim, the plaint should contain the amount which has been so allowed. The plaint should contain the value of the suit and the subject matter, not only the purpose of jurisdiction, but also the purpose of court fees. At last, the content that should be on the plaint is plaintiff verification on the oath. This shows the Rule 1. That is the written statement. A defendant should, within the 30 days from the service of the summons on him, present a written statement of his defense. The period that is extendable up to 90 days, but for reasons to be recorded for such extension. A written statement should be drafted carefully. Now, all the general rules of the pleading apply to a written statement also. Before proceeding to draft a written statement, it is absolutely necessary to examine the plaint carefully. Like a plaintiff, a defendant may also take a number of defenses, either simply or in the alternative. Even though they may be consistent or rather very inconsistent, provided that they are maintainable at law and are not embarrassing. Now, Rule 1A provides for the duty of the defendant to produce documents upon which relief is claimed or relied upon him. Moving forward to Rule 2. What happened? New facts must be specially pleaded. The effect of the rule is for reasons of practice and justice and convenience to require the party to tell his opponent that what he is coming to prove to the court. Moving further, if he does not do so, the court will in two ways. It may say that it is not open to him, that he has not raised it and will not be allowed to him, or it may give leave to amend or leave to amend by raising it and protect the other party. Now, rule third is the denial to public. The defendant must specifically deny each allegations of the fact which he does not admit the truth. Now, rule fourth is evasive denial, where a defendant denies an allegation of the fact in the plaint. He must not do but answer the points of substance. Thus, if the allegation that he received a certain sum of money, it shall not be sufficient to deny that he received that particular amount, but he must deny that he received a sum, or else set out how much he received. Moving further to Rule 5, that is special or specific denial. Rule 3 of Order 8 requires that the defendant must deal specifically with the allegation effect of which he does not admit the truth. Rule 5 provides that every allegation of fact in the plaint, if not denied in the written statement, shall be taken to be admitted by the defendant. Now, what this rule says is that any allegation of fact must be either denied or specifically or by a necessary implication, or there should be at least a least statement that the fact is not admitted. If the plea is not taken in the manner, then the allegation shall not be admitted. Now, we'll move forward that if his denial of a fact is not specific but evasive, the said fact shall be taken to be admitted. In such an event, the admission itself being proved, no other proof is necessary. So, moving forward to Rule 7, defense or set off founder upon separate grounds, where the defendant relies upon several distinct grounds of defense or set off, founded separate or distinct facts, they will be stated as far as may be separately or distinctly. Now comes Rule 8, that is new ground of defense. The additional ground of defense must be taken before the commencement of the trial. A plea that the suit was liable to be stayed in view of an arbitration clause in the contract was held to be waived, although an additional written statement containing such plea was filed and accepted by the trial court. Coming forward to Rule 9, what is subsequent pleading? Order 8, Rule 9, CPC lays down an important rule of pleading that no pleading subsequent to the written statement by a defendant other than by way to set off shall be presented except by the leave of the court. The rule requires the leave of the court before any party can make a further pleading. After written statement has been filed, where a defendant intends to file the additional written statement, he must file an application showing the circumstances as to which he failed to rise and to raise the plea in the original written statement, and the other party must be given opportunity to make the party must be set out in the pleadings. Moreover, the relief cannot be claimed on the grounds which are not contained in the pleadings. The immaterial or vague or ambiguous matter should be avoided, and the pleadings should be properly framed. In the case named Devaki Nandan versus Muralidhar, it was held that a finding cannot be sustained which is based on no pleading and no evidence. That is, that if you need to file a case, if you want to file a case, you must support your case with proper drafting, with proper evidence. Otherwise, definitely your case will not be so strong that why the judge will give the decision in your favor. Moving further, pleadings are those materials or essential facts which are necessary to be averred in order to put forward a cause or to establish defense in a judicial proceeding. It is the backbone of the suit upon which the entire edifice of the suit rests. It includes allegations and counter-allegations made by one party and denied by the other. It means that a formal statement to propound the cause of action or set up a defense against the case of the plaintiff. Now, there is a person named Mova. According to Mova, pleading that the statement in writing drawn up and filed by each party to a case stating what his contentions will be at the trial and giving all such details as his opponent needs to know in order to prepare his case in the answer. Now, Order 6 of the Code of CPC 1908 deals with the pleadings in the general. Rule 1 defines pleading. Rule 2 defines